Stephen Mathai-Davis, Chief Investment Officer at Quantamize, is here. And we are going to be talking both stocks and ETFs in an extended market call. Welcome to the new year on Moneyline. Yes, it's market call time, and our market call today, well, we've never done one like this before. We've done extended market calls, and we've had guests on who have talked about stocks and funds or stocks and ETFs, but we've never had somebody where we're going to say, here's their stock methodology, and then come back and say, here's their ETF methodology. So you're going to get a double helping of hold it or fold it. One on stocks, one on ETFs. The ETFs will be folded into a separate segment. So after this is done, stay with us and we'll get to the ETFs. Now, we can do that because my guest is Stephen Mathai-Davis. He is Chief Investment Officer at Quantamize. Quantamize.com is the website. Now, if you go there, there is a huge suite of research tools and it's growing dramatically. Stephen was on the show with us basically at the beginning of the summer and was talking about what was coming. Well, some of it has already come. Quantamize has a new ETF lineup of products. You can learn about that at the website. But there's also a lot there that's basically using ways to be a quantitative analyst, to kind of put quantitative analysis and artificial intelligence to work to decide what you should be buying. It is a very different approach and, like I said, a very different market. If you want more information besides the website, on Twitter at Quantalytics RES for Quantalytics Research. Stephen Mathai-Davis, Happy New Year. Welcome back to Money Life.
Hey, Chuck. Happy New Year. So psyched to be back on the show with you today.
Well, I'm stunned that you have time because with what you guys are doing at Quantamize, you are more than a little busy bringing out new things. So I appreciate the time that you're taking, but let's talk about how Quantamize works because we have to start with methodology.
And, absolutely.
And like I said, for the average investor, quantitative analysis is something we leave to everybody else because we don't have the tools. But part of what Quantamize is doing isn't just using those tools, it's sort of making them available.
Yeah. Well, our goal here at Quantamize is to democratize access to AI and quantitative research for the individual investors, people like your listeners. Right now, what we do is we look at close to 10,000 stocks, 3,000 ETFs, I've lost count of the number of options we look at, and roughly 100 different cryptos. And what we try to do is apply really complicated deep learning AI models to make sense of markets, and then use multi-factor frameworks to make sense and put AI and quantitative investing into English for the average person, give them ideas about what they should be looking at, what should they be buying, what should they be selling, what really makes sense.
Quantitative analysis, it all comes out to the guy who's the quant. It's kind of like, how do I set my measures and say, this is what's important to me, that's what's important to me. You guys actually do it on a couple of different bases, right? So explain how it works and how somebody should know that, like, okay, this is what I'm looking for.
Yeah, let's talk stocks for a moment. What we do with stocks is very something, I guess, it's simplistic from a logical standpoint, but it's really complicated. What we try to do is first use the AI models to find factors that actually predict the performance of stocks. After we do that, we take those factors and we use them to rank and score stocks in the U.S., Europe, Asia, Latin America, and even India. But here's where we're different. We're looking at different factors in the U.S. than we are looking at in China. That means our models are completely heterogeneous. And I'm sure it's obvious to a lot of your listeners. The factors driving stocks in China are going to be very different than the factors driving consumer discretionary stocks in the U.S.
So I always love talking with quantitative managers. You can ask them, what's your favorite stock? And they'll say, I don't have one, but the system tells me I like this. So for you, because you use your analytics both on the broad side, markets, sectors, et cetera, and on the granular side with stocks, what are the areas of the market that looks good? What does the market look like to you right now?
Yeah, I want to highlight two different areas. I'd like to talk about U.S. consumer discretionary European stocks, and taking a step back just for a moment, how are we coming up with that? Well, we have a circuit of neural networks. That means we're using multiple different types of deep learning algorithms to figure out what sectors, what regions actually make the most sense. And that's been one of the innovative things we've been doing at Quantamize for the past year to 2 years, is building out these deep learning networks, training them, and teaching them to find out what really works and what doesn't. And the two areas that I'd really want to talk about is actually the U.S. consumer discretionary sector and the European large cap sector. So let me just talk about consumer discretionary for a moment. Right now, it's roughly, give or take, 17% down for the fourth quarter. It's trading at a forward 12-month PE of 17.7%, with earnings growth expected to be roughly 18 times. Chuck, that translates to a peg below 1 and would imply the market is over-discounting next year's growth. The forward PE of 17.7 is its lowest that it's been for large-cap consumer discretionary stocks since 2016. And it's more in line with its five-year average. And just for some context, this is in spite of earnings growth accelerating. So here's some stocks that we think make the most sense that have been highlighted both by our multi-factor models as well as our deep learning algorithms. Domino's Pizza, McDonald's, AutoZone, Darden Restaurant. These are stocks we think some of your subscribers and listeners who are interested in consumer discretionary in the U.S. should consider.
Okay. But if they're interested, so out of curiosity, you have both a sector that's looking good, and then you have those particular names looking good within that sector. What percentage of names look good within that sector? Is it a straight bell curve? Is it, you know, hey, once we've analyzed what sectors look good, we're going to take the top 10% of the names there and make those the ones we're looking at? You know, what else goes into it?
Yeah, that's a really good question. So when we look at just consumer discretionary alone, it's more or less a bell curve. We're taking the top 10%. But when we're looking at just the aggregate U.S. market, period, we don't. It's not a bell curve approach. It's completely unconstrained. So in the case of consumer discretionary, if you were to look at the number of stocks that you would consider top buys just for you as large cap, close to 20% right now are consumer discretionary. All these names I just highlighted are both top buys in the sector model as well as in this aggregate U.S. large cap model of ours.
And again, what you said was that the market, you believe, has sort of been overly discounted in terms of the way things are reacting. Does that mean you have some expectation for this new year as to what you expect to see in the market in terms of bounce back from the downturn we've seen or rebound or...
Yeah, I think we want to be careful, Chuck, giving you too far an outlook, because one of the limitations with AI and quantitative investing, it's very difficult to really give you a long-tail projection. I can tell you right now what's going on. It's beginning of the year, and our AI models, where we're running, again, like I mentioned, several different types of deep learning neural networks to come up with trading signals, continue to highlight consumer discretionary as a buy. It's something that's shocking to me, given the environment that we're in at the moment. But I've learned over the past 2-3 years not to go against the models when they're being contrary.
What is it telling you not to buy right now?
It's interesting. What is it telling me not to buy? Industrials and staples. If you're thinking about a pair trade at the moment, if you want to look in consumer space, maybe long consumer discretionary and short staples, because right now consumer discretionary is a buy and U.S. consumer staples is a short. For those of your listeners who are interested in trades like that.
And is that, to some extent, also just because of the action that we've seen, that fundamentally discretionary is a buy because that's been more beaten down in this downturn, and staples have been what, oh, well, you know, you can always buy the staples because people are always going to need those, and so they're, you know, they're a little more whatever. Is that actually a direct reaction to the recent action we've seen in the market?
I want to be careful. I wouldn't say it's a direct reaction, Chuck, because we're using a lot of alternative data as well. So our model is certainly considering a lot of price data and fundamental data, but it's considering a lot of alternative data like retail sales as well as sentiment data. So I would tell you what's being captured here is probably both what you hear in the noise in the market as well as the reality on the ground.
Now, in terms of what you are buying and how the system works. How long, because as you point out, you're not necessarily looking out too far. How long, if we say something's a buy, does it typically remain a buy? Or maybe that's not the right way to look at it because it can, of course, remain a buy indefinitely. But where does it have to fall to on that bell curve if it's being analyzed within the bell curve to get off of the buy list? You know, where's your hold point? Where's your sell point?
Usually, the outlooks we're giving are roughly 30 to 90 days. Some of the strategies I just discussed here are really more of a 30-day to 90-day outlook. So in terms of consumer discretionary, if you were to ask me what am I talking about, I'm probably talking really more about the first quarter of 2019.
And for somebody who wants to play this, and I want to hold off a little bit on the ETF talk because it's coming, but
sure.
For somebody who wants to play this, if they want to do this using ETFs, does it make sense for them to be using sector ETFs?
Yeah, I'm going to lead into that. You're going to be excited by that. We've created an AI portfolio where you buy sectors, where it's using hierarchical risk parity, which is completely different. It's looking for nonlinear relationships between stocks and ETFs, and it's creating portfolios that would be more robust and stable, as well as maximizing returns. And can I touch on that for a moment, Chuck?
Sure.
I think for your listeners who are looking for something a little longer, maybe this, what we're talking about right now, doesn't make sense. We've also had something we call Q-folios. That's short for quantitative portfolios. They're super concentrated portfolios. But let me give you an example. We have a quality value portfolio. It's 15 stocks. It rebalances monthly. The turnover has been roughly 40% annualized. And it's been up close to 18% last year. That's pretty good.
Yep.
Long only. Sortino north of 1.8. A sharp that is roughly 1.5. So for listeners like those of those who may be more interested in something that's a little bit longer term, we would suggest they check out our quantitative portfolios, because that's more geared towards somebody saying, look, I'm not trading in and out of this over the next month or 3 months. I'm trying to take a 6-month outlook, a 12-month outlook.
Well, now we're going to see how that outlook comes together for some stocks that my audience is particularly interested in.
Play, hold it.
You got to know when to hold up.
Or fold it.
Know when to fold up.
It's the first of two rounds of Hold It or Fold It today with Stephen Mathai-Davis. He's Chief Investment Officer at Quantamize. Quantamize.com is the website, at Quantalytics R-E-S. On Twitter if you are interested, and we're going to start talking stocks today. Now, Hold It or Fold It, it's where we put our guests to your test. And if you want to test our guests, send your name, your hometown, and the ticker symbols you're interested in. Stocks, mutual funds, closed-end funds, ETFs, whatever you got, send it to chuck@moneylifeshow.com. We're going to start today with a request we got from Tom in Louisville and Rich in Gig Harbor, Washington. They both wanted to know about Home Depot. That's HD.
Home Depot. I know this is a popular one. We'd hold it, and we'd be buying it left and right if we could today. Top buy in two models, both our large cap and our consumer discretionary model. And by the way, Chuck, you know, we were talking about the neural networks giving you, picking out stocks or ETFs. What I didn't talk about is the fact we also have neural networks that are saying, of your top buys, here are the things you should be buying. Home Depot's been a screaming buy for the last 2 weeks.
I have to ask, because throughout 2018, every time we talked to Home Depot, we wound up talking about Lowe's. So if Home Depot is a screaming buy, what does that do, if anything, for Lowe's, same sector, different business?
Yeah, I hate to disappoint your listeners. I know they'd love to hear me say Lowe's is a short, sell it here. The reality is the models are not saying that. If you own Lowe's, I wouldn't sell it, but it's not something I'd be running around telling you to buy right now. We look at models, our factors are broken down into quality value, growth, low volatility momentum, technicals. Lowe's is more or less a neutral to slightly attractive in all those categories. Nothing like Home Depot, though.
So, Home Depot, yeah, screaming buy. That's what we're saying there.
You can see your equity increase tenfold.
On HD. Meanwhile, for Lowe's,
no money changes hands today.
Yep. Rich in Gig Harbor, Washington, had a second request. This for Microsoft, ticker symbol MSFT, and I have to say, it's in my portfolio.
I would have to disappoint you there. I'm going to tell you to fold it. It's neutral in U.S. large cap. It's attractive in our tech-only model. But look, if you look at quality value, which is something that should matter to people right now in this environment, it's not scoring very well at all.
Sell immediately. Entire portfolio at market regardless of cost.
That's a fold on Microsoft, MSFT. Mike in Redwood City, California wants to know about Take-Two Interactive Software. That's TTWO.
I would hold it. I'm not sure I'd be adding to it, but look, it's a neutral in our U.S. large cap, and it's attractive in our tech model. The quality value scores are pretty mediocre, but it's got some awesome growth factor scores in both U.S. large cap and in tech. And here's the tiebreaker. The technicals are saying it's attractive, so we're saying own it.
Okay.
Don't fold it.
So it's not a buy, but hold it if you got it. You're not buying more on TTWO, Take Two Interactive.
I don't want people dumping their shares.
Richard in Chula Vista, California wants to know about Alphabet. That, of course, is Google, G-O-O-G.
I hate to disappoint the listeners here, but fold it. It's neutral in U.S. large cap and in our U.S. tech models, but look, it's got terrible quality value and terrible technical factor scores, and the AI models just don't like it at all.
It's topped out. I say we sell now.
That's a fold on Google, G-O-O-G. And last, in this part of Hold It or Fold It, for Herb in Oradell, New Jersey, it's SunTrust Banks, ticker symbol STI, and my audience has heard me say I've inherited some stocks from my relations. Well, that's one of them.
SunTrust. Well, Herb, we're neighbors, and I would tell you to hold it. It's a neutral and U.S. large cap, but our AI quant models love its technical and quality value exposure. I wouldn't be selling it here, but probably wouldn't be buying any more either.
So you're riding along with SunTrust, ticker symbol STI.
And look at all the money I'm making.
And speaking of riding along, well, we're going to ride along for just a little bit longer here, take a little break, and when we come back, we're going to do more Hold It or Fold It. We'll tell you a little bit about how the ETF setup works at Quantamize, and then we will bring you five more Hold It or Fold It picks, this time all talking about ETFs. Again, my guest, Stephen Mathai-Davis from Quantamize. Quantamize.com to learn more, to be able to look at how your things do on their scores, to learn about their ETFs, etc. on Twitter at QuantalyticsRTS. Stay tuned. We'll be back with a little more from Stephen right after this message. Welcome back to Money Life. Our final segment today is pretty unusual for us to do a second helping of Hold It or Fold It.
Do you hold them or fold them?
And we're going to be asking that question again to Stephen Mathai-Davis, Chief Investment Officer at Quantamize. But where we were just talking stocks with Stephen, now we're going to be talking ETFs. Quantamize has its own suite of ETF products that are brand new. You can learn more about that and their ETF research at Quantamize.com. Again, on Twitter at QuantalyticsRTS. So, Stephen, let's jump right back into this. You know, we started really talking methodology, and it is the same kind of quantitative approach, but evaluating an ETF is different than evaluating a stock. So help my audience understand a little bit about the differences here.
Yeah, that's a great point, Chuck. They're similar, but a little bit different. Here was the genesis of what we were trying to do. If we were able to build some awesome multi-factor models using AI that would help predict stocks, theoretically, you'd be able to create risk models based on that and measure the value of ETFs and mutual funds, see whether or not they were really exposed to the different factor groups we had. And that's what we've done. This is the first product ever for your listeners that actually looks at an ETF and actually answers the question, what's really the beta in that ETF? You know, my friends are telling me to buy this value ETF. I hear somebody else on TV saying buy this value ETF. I don't know what to buy. They're all the same thing. What's the difference between an iShares large cap value ETF and a Vanguard large cap value ETF? Well, we're here to help you find that answer. On Quantamize.com now, we just released a suite of products, one of which is our smart beta scores and ratings. We score and rate ETFs based on categories, whether it be value, low volatility, momentum, Asia, dividends, to tell you what's really the beta and portfolio attribution in that ETF. At the same time, what we've tried to do is build out buy-sell signals across roughly 300 different ETFs. They're broken down into categories, and we split out our sector and smart beta scores into its own standalone product. So when you come to Quantamize.com, just click the sector AI trading signals, and you'll find out what sectors you should be buying over the next month or 2 months.
Right, and again, it's relatively short-term in terms of nature.
It's roughly 30 to 60 days.
Is there a poster child for the methodology? You know, you talked about Home Depot kind of just killing it when it came to the stocks and being at the top of the charts. Is there that kind of an ETF that we can point to as well that's the poster child for the methodology right now?
There are a couple. I'm hesitant to highlight one versus the other. It's a little bit different looking at ETFs versus stocks. But let me talk about one that I guess is going to fall a little bit into your hold it and fold it category. That would be IGE, that's North American Natural Resources. It's a screaming buy. It's one of the only buys outside of consumer discretionary in our sector AI trading signals category.
Keith in Burlington, Vermont wanted to know about IGE. So it's a screaming buy. What makes that particularly right now?
That's interesting. You know, we don't get too far behind the hood. I can tell you what we look at when we just look at sectors. We're looking at how they interact with each other, how they're interacting with other ETFs. We look at sentiment data, implied volatility and options markets data. We're looking at retail-related data. We're pulling in a lot of alternative data. At the moment, we're crunching north of 100 million different data points to come up with these signals. But if I can take you on a slight detour for a moment, when people talk about factors, and I'm sure your listeners hear about it all the time, they're being told, why don't you buy value? Because that's what you should be buying right now. And just to highlight something, of the 20 value ETFs we own, we rank right now using our neural networks for buy-sell signals, only one is a buy, and that's a quality value factor, which would tell me that we should really be focusing not just on value, but on quality. We did a study a couple of weeks ago where we look at low volatility ETFs and value ETFs, and we tried to see what's better to own in this environment. Just give a context. Over the past decade, the S&P 500 has been down in 12 quarters. Over the course of those 12 quarters, low vol has outperformed the general market in 8 of them. In comparison, value has only performed in 6. Just to give you context, the low volatility ETFs have outperformed value by nearly 10 points over that period. So when people talk about value, I would tell you, folks, maybe put down whatever phone or Twitter feed you're listening to and go take a look at low vol.
Okay.
That's the smarter bit to consider here.
Okay, so low vol over value, that's a general message. Also in there, a screaming buy on IGE, the iShares S&P North American Natural Resources ETF. Now, we've got to kind of play a little catch-up here and do this quickly. Since we were talking about the broad market, let's go to a request from Craig in Belleville, Texas, for the RSP, the Guggenheim S&P 500 Equal Weight ETF.
Yeah, this is a little shocking. This is actually one of my favorite ETFs. But look, at the end of the day, I follow what the neural networks are telling me, and we have a circuit of neural networks that are telling us this is a sell right here. So I would avoid it and sell it.
Okay. So again, for you, what we're actually saying is good ETF, bad time. Good.
That would be the right way to read it.
Yeah. So good ETF, bad timing on the Guggenheim S&P 500 Equal Weight. RSP was a fold.
I say we sell now.
Brent in Chandler, Arizona wants to know about Vanguard Midcap. That's VO. Any better fortunes in the midcap space?
Listen, this one's an even bigger shocker for me since intuitively I would say buy this space. It's a great ETF, but the neural networks don't like it right now.
Oh, boy. That sounded bad.
Yep. That was a fold on the VO, the Vanguard Midcap ETF. Mark in Mitchell, South Dakota wants to know about the Spider Stocks Europe 50, FEU.
Finally, I have some good news for you, Chuck. We think it's a buy. We think it's something your folks should really consider here. It's one of the more attractive looking ETFs also in the European space. And just stand alone, we think it's a buy over the next month to 2 months.
Come on, let's buy.
So a buy on the FEU, the Spider Stocks Europe 50. And last, Tim in East Longmeadow, Massachusetts goes really granular. He wants to know about the Global X MSCI Argentina ETF. It's ticker ARGT.
Yeah, this was one of my favorite ones because I'm actually Latin Americanist by training. Unfortunately, MSCI Argentina is one of the worst ETFs, period, in Latin America, and it's a sell here. I would not own it right now at all.
Somehow I'm not surprised. I am the voice of lacrosse in Argentina, having done 7 of their games at the last World Championships. And as one of my friends who's involved in their thing said, Chuck, I don't think there is a voice of sound personal finance in Argentina. So, not surprisingly, the Global X MSCI Argentina ETF ARGT.
Put that one on the psycho list.
Yep, put it on the psycho list. That was a fold. Definitely not on the psycho list. Definitely fun to chat with and can't wait to do it again. Stephen Mathai-Davis. Stephen, this was great. Thank you so much for doing this. We look forward to chatting with you down the line in 2019.
Thanks, Chuck. It was great to be on the show again.
That's Stephen Mathai-Davis. He's Chief Investment Officer at Quantamize. If you want to learn more about what they're doing and the differences they've got, quantamize.com, on Twitter at QuantalyticsRES. Okay, we're just about done with our first show in the new year. But I'll tell you what's coming for the rest of the week. Maybe give you an outlook for a little bit deeper than that before we send you home right after this message.